For those of you who don't know me, I am Brodie Butland. I am an attorney in Cleveland with the law firm of Porter Wright, the mothership's in Columbus, but I'm in the branch office in Cleveland. Primarily, I do business litigation, primarily things like antitrust compliance, products liability, business contracts, etc. But a couple years ago, I started a subspecialty in gym and fitness law, complements of this organization. So thank you all for allowing me to expand beyond the usual types of law. I am now the gym and fitness department at Porter Wright. So. Just a couple things before we begin, for the safety of my employer, some CYA. Number one is that this presentation is for educational purposes only, and the opinions expressed herein are solely mine and do not necessarily reflect that of Porter Wright or any other person. They do, however, have the advantage of being correct. This presentation should not be construed as legal advice or guidance for any particular matter and should not be construed as an attorney-client relationship. Okay, I am very happy to be an attorney for anybody who wants, but you have to contact me first and then pay your bills on time. And then last, do not think you are capable of resolving your own legal issues solely because you listen to some guy speak at the SSCA conference. You should know better. Every matter is different, and legal work involves highly specific determinations. A lawyer who represents himself has a fool for a client. Don't be a fool. So, with that out of the way, here's what we're going to talk about. Number one, we're going to begin with waivers. That's a really big deal. I think those of you who have heard me talk before know I consider that kind of the indispensable first part of any legal protection in a gym, in addition to your insurance coverage. We're going to talk about cases that have been decided in the last year that reflect on these waiver principles. We'll then cover unique issues with online legal training because it's becoming a lot more popular these days. I know a lot of you have at least some clients who are more or less exclusively online. We'll then cover AED requirements. There are 12 states that actually require you to have them and require you to have certain types of training. I'm hoping you are not going to learn that you are in one of those states for the first time today, but if you are, it's a good thing you came. And then we're just going to do a quick update on the state of licensure. So, where do we begin? Well, first, written waiver. I'm going to, you know, I've talked about this before, and I'm going to bore you again if you've already heard it twice, but there are four main requirements for a waiver to be enforceable, as I've seen in the gym and fitness law, and these are the four areas where if a waiver is held invalid, it usually falls in one of these four categories. Number one is it has to be conspicuous. That is to say, it has to be obvious that they're signing some type of a waiver. It can't just be something that's buried in the back of a document. It has to fairly cover the circumstances at issue. The particular injury has to be contemplated by the waiver language. Negligence must be expressly stated. It's not just enough to say, well, I waive all liability. If you're going to waive any claims relating to your own negligence, you must expressly state it. And then last, for public policy reasons, you cannot waive intentional misconduct. We don't want people just beating the crap out of their trainees, right? We don't want them to be able to waive that ability. So intentional misconduct, reckless and wanton conduct. Sometimes you see gross negligence as well. It's a really fuzzy line between all of them, but basically, if it's anything other than ordinary negligence, you are not protected. So I think that this case decided in the Missouri appeals this past year is actually a really good explanation of the conspicuousness. A term or clause is conspicuous if it is clearly visible or obvious. Whether a printed clause is conspicuous as a matter of law usually depends on the size and style of the typeface. Now, usually for waivers, I draft a separate document because then there's no confusion what you're signing whatsoever. It says waiver and release on the top. Every provision afterwards says you lose, and then you sign at the bottom. There's no question as to what exactly the waiver or what exactly you're signing. But there are sometimes, for business reasons, people like to put the waiver into the actual client engagement document or programming document or whatever. So if you do, make sure that it's very clear. In the McNierney case, the heading release of liability, and then you had the waiver provision afterwards, was in bold capitalized and underlined type. And the court said that's good enough. It was very clear what it was. There was another case decided out of Pennsylvania this year as well in the Pennsylvania trial court that held the same thing for a heading that said liability of waiver, and except this one was bold italics and capitalized as opposed to underlined. But the point is, you know, waivers are important in how we protect ourselves with our businesses. So don't be ashamed of having a waiver. There's no reason to bury it in a document, not just for legal purposes, but also because, frankly, if a trainee really doesn't want to train with you because there's a possibility they'll be injured, well, I mean, there's a good chance that's going to come true at some point down the road. Fairly covers the circumstances. Link v. Fitness, there are actually two Illinois appeals courts that I'm going to talk about, one which reaches the result that I like and one that reaches a result I don't, but I think we need to cover both of them. Now, in Link v. Fitness, a trainee suffered rhabdomyolysis after his second training session. Now, just a little bit of factual background. He was a relatively detrained individual. He did a first workout, didn't have any problems afterwards, but a couple days started feeling sore. Second workout, he comes in, starts working out, feels pain during the session, and then has limited range of motion. He can't actually move his arms the whole way. Trainer tells him, we'll just keep going. He ends up having red urine a couple days later, and he is diagnosed with rhabdo. Now, the court held that the waiver, even though rhabdo was not necessarily a disease that they knew about, in fact, I believe the trainer didn't even know what rhabdo was when he was training the guy. He had never heard of it. But what the court held was that when the waiver said all physical injury, rhabdomyolysis was included under all physical injury, even if the precise disease may not have been necessarily known to the trainee or even the trainer. So I like that decision a lot. I don't like the next one quite as much, however. Now, just to explain this case a little bit, I'm actually going to give you the waiver language that applied. Okay, so I'm just going to give you a couple seconds to read that so that you know what the waiver actually was, and then when we can discuss the facts. And I'm in your all's way. I get to read this stuff for a living, by the way. I have a really exciting job. So, here are the facts of the case. Jim Patron is playing basketball, and he slips on a puddle of water that was caused by a leaky roof. Okay? Does the waiver cover this or not? I guess I sort of already gave away the answer, but who says the answer is this waiver should cover that? And who says it should not? Okay. It was actually a split opinion. It was 2-1. So first we have the majority, Justice Sheldon Harris. Who said that if you haven't watched Game of Thrones, you are not going to understand this, so just talk to someone who does after the presentation. So the majority held that the exculpatory clause does not make any mention of shielding defendant from liability from the building itself being defective. Plaintiff could not possibly have foreseen or contemplated that a leak from a defective roof would cause his injury. What the majority said is, look, there is a possibility of water being on the gym floor, but it's going to be from something like sweat, it's going to be from something like a water bottle, it's not going to be from a leaky roof. Now, I actually take this into account when I draft waivers for gyms for a very specific reason, because there is a possibility that you'll have a judge who says, well, premises liability doesn't fall under training liability, so we're going to separate the two. There was a dissent who took the majority to task for this distinction, which it considered a kind of artificial. And that's not the actual quote. the dissent said the exact same thing as the majority. No, what the dissent said was that, so the dissent said that this is a very artificial distinction between the two, that if you expect that there's a possibility that water's on the ground, it doesn't really matter how the water got there, whether it's a leaky roof, whether it's a water bottle, etc. Here's the point. Even though I believe that the waiver language that we covered earlier would fairly cover the circumstances, I also don't have a robe. So my opinion doesn't necessarily matter, but this is something we need to keep in mind. If you're in a state like Illinois, which tends to be somewhat plaintiff friendly and tries to find exceptions to waivers, it would be a good idea to make sure that you have a specific premises liability provision in addition to your liability provision. I think that's the takeaway of it. So we've covered fairly covers circumstances. Let's talk about expressly waiving negligence. And I think that the McNierney case has a really good statement of the rule. This is one of the better statements I've seen from a case this year. The exculpatory language must effectively notify a party that he or she is releasing the other party from claims arising from the other party's own negligence. General language will not suffice. So you got to have the words negligence or fault so that a clear and unmistakable waiver and shifting of risk occurs. Okay, what this means is use the term negligence, right? Use the term negligence, use the term fault. Don't try to be cute with it. You know, you don't want to give an out to the court to try to find that your waiver doesn't apply. In the McNierney case, by the way, the waiver read, it said it had a whole bunch of things that could potentially happen, and then it said that it waived any claims, including those resulting from the negligence of Lifetime Fitness. They said that's enough. Now here's a case that sort of relates to the willfulness thing, but in a way that I'm going to explain in a little bit. You may have seen this headline. This is the single biggest verdict I've ever seen against a gem for negligence. So $14.5 million. The gym patron was held 25% contributorily negligent, so they lopped off a fourth of this in the final, but it's still over $10 million. So a very, very large verdict. Now, there are two things that happen in this case that I think makes it unique and something that it's very unlikely we would ever encounter something like this. Now, first of all, the guy was a doctor, and he had about 20, 25 years left on his career, and because of his stroke, he was unable to be a doctor anymore. That's a lot of lost wages, right? A lot of lost wages, a lot of pain and suffering. So in some sense, the massive verdict is not necessarily representative of what a lot of your trainees may do. But here are the other things that were factored into the case. Number one, Connecticut doesn't allow waivers for recreational activities. So there is no way that this gym could have actually protected themselves through a waiver anyway. They had to have higher insurance limits. The other problem is how the trainer actually approached the session. Middle-aged doctor, clearly out of shape, 42, is coming in to get a session. It was either the second or the third session, the trainer put him on the rower or the rowing machine at the highest setting. The guy keeps turning the thing down and saying, I can't do it at that level, and the trainer says, no, we're gonna turn it up again. Okay, so far not great. Then, when they go to bench press and push-ups, the guy claims that he has blurred vision and a sudden onset of severe pain. Blurred vision, severe pain is usually a good time to cut the workout short. But no, the trainer said, just keep going, keep doing some more sets and keep doing some more push-ups, right? So, needless to say, the jury was not happy with this, and the expert witnesses said there was definitely a causation between the two. Whether that's true or not doesn't really matter. The point is the doctor said it, and the facts were so egregious in this case that there's no way the jury was gonna cut the guy a break. But here's the other lesson to it. So I've talked in previous years about how sometimes conduct can be so egregious, so negligent, that it actually crosses from the threshold from negligence into recklessness. I think this might have actually been one of those cases, even if the waiver was enforceable. If your trainee says that they have blurred vision, that they're having severe pain, that they can't do it, and you're still forcing them to do it anyway, well, I won't say forcing, that there's a reason why the doctor was held a quarter negligent, but compelling your trainee who's trusting you to know what's best for them, you may actually cross the threshold into willfulness, and now you're not protected. Hmm?
Sounds like Patriot.
Yeah. Yeah, it's and that's actually the definition of a wanton and malicious. I mean, it's actually like hatred. It looks like it. I mean, if you wanted to abuse the poor guy, what would you do differently? So I think this is an important case for us to know about. Not necessarily because it could happen to you, because I don't think anybody in this room would have quite the egregious case of client abuse that this represents. But nonetheless, it's still important to just specify, you know, as an organization, we believe it's important to take care of your trainees. Just do so, you know, and if God forbid one of them gets injured, as long as you're doing your best and as long as you're not doing stupid stuff, you probably will be protected by a waiver. A couple notable mentions for cases. First of all, out of New York. By the way, New York, everything's backward. The Supreme Court is actually the lowest court. So New York Supreme Court, this is just like some judge. It's not like a panel of seven. It may help explain too, Law and Order, why when you hear the little bump bum and then you see Supreme Court part whatever, that's what they're talking about. So, you learn stuff about pop culture in these talks too. So what Tilyaev held was that a parent's signature alone did not bind a child on a waiver. So just the parent signed the waiver, and the court said, well, you know what? You can't waive your child's right. This is why in the waivers that I've drafted for the last 2 years, I always put a separate line for parent and child on a line, so that way they both have to sign it. Now, I will say this rule is not universal. A Michigan Court of Appeals in 2008, Sully perked up. A Michigan court in 2008 held exactly this as well, that a parent could not waive the rights of a child, and the legislature actually reversed that decision by passing a statute that said that parents actually can. Because the problem you have with minors is, can they actually consent to waiver? And, you know, so I think in Tilyaev, of course, that issue was not presented to the court, but it could put you in a catch-22. That's why I just frankly have both sign it, because that's the best chance of making sure that something's enforceable. The other one is Fall v. LA Fitness. This actually is a case of religious discrimination. Now, normally I would not talk about religious discrimination, except that I think this one is somewhat relevant to our businesses. In this case, A Muslim American was told that he could not do a particular type of prayer in a particular area of the locker room because he was blocking a few exits. You know, he was blocking the lockers, blocking the bathrooms, and so three people came up to him from the gym and said, hey, you can't pray here. So he brought a religious discrimination claim under Title II, which applies to all places of public accommodation. If you run a gym, Title II applies to you. Now, the court here said that there was no evidence that anybody was treated differently in the gym. There was no evidence, for example, that other people were allowed to pray in the same area. There was no evidence that employees would allow people to pray elsewhere, and this particular individual was allowed to pray in other areas of the gym. He said, as long as I have a wall, it doesn't really matter where I pray. And he, in fact, prayed in the stairwell sometimes. He prayed in other parts of the gym, and the gym never raised an issue with it. So the reason why I'm pointing this case out to you is, number one, just to confirm, Title II does, in fact, apply to you, and you are not allowed to discriminate on the basis of race, color, religion, or national origin. Yes, Reb?
Well, it appears to me as though this whole thing could have been completely avoided by not saying the word pray.
Mm-hmm.
Look, you idiot, you cannot be on your knees in my stairwell. You cannot be on your knees in the way. I don't care what you're doing on your knees.
Mm-hmm.
You're not allowed to be on your knees. That's simple.
Yeah. So what Rip has said is, you know, rather than bring prey into it, the way they might have been able to avoid it is just say, hey, look, we can't have you laying down there. You're blocking an entrance. Yeah, so it's, yeah, I mean, it's a safety hazard. So, and that's the way they could have handled it.
Safety
But they didn't. Yes, Wolf?
Would that, this specific case aside, would that Title II apply in a private training facility the same way it does in, gym?
Yeah, well, and that is that is a good question. My inclination is yes, it would, because it would be a really easy way to get out of Title II requirements if you could just say, hey, we're just private. But I mean, the basic point is treat everybody the same, right? I mean, if you allow somebody to pray in an area, then let everybody pray in that area. If you don't allow people to pray in a certain area, make sure nobody gets to, right? I mean, just treat everybody equally in your gym and you won't have to worry about this. Now, in this particular case, the guy, I think, was going to bring a lawsuit regardless, but, and that just happens sometimes. But he did lose, and I mean, this was a Democratic appointee judge, Susan DeLott, who is a very good judge in Ohio, and she said, no dice, you don't have a claim here.
Yeah.
This is more kind of big picture. You're talking about public accommodation. So everyone who owns a gym is counts as public accommodation. If you own, let's say, a garage gym, you either have routine or repeating clients or something like that. It's kind of a delineated, designated space. You file it on your taxes as, your break for that space in your house. Does that make that section of your house about public accommodation so all laws would apply to that?
Great question from CJ. What if you open up a home gym? Did you just create a place of public accommodation that Title II applies to? Candidly, I don't know the answer to that, given that it's a private residence. I just don't know. What I would say is, just as a matter of business, it's usually a good idea to treat everybody the same. So, so you probably could avoid any of this regardless of what the rule is. Yeah, I mean, I don't know the answer to that, frankly. I don't know Title II law well enough to answer that. So,
I bet you know how you fight the case,
though. Oh, I am capable of looking up law, and learning what the legal rules are and finding cases that support my side. I'm very good at that, and I'm a quick learner.